昼でございますわね。5人揃ってのお昼は久しぶりだね。やっぱりこうじゃないとダメだよね。
まったく同感同感。ほらほらケイちゃんも机寄せて。
Satoko brought her own desk over as well, grinning broadly. Even knowing nothing had been resolved, this exchange was pleasant and made me remember how fun it used to be.
いつまでもリカにお弁当を作ってもらっては悪いですわね。いいのですよ。サトコのお弁当を作るのは僕の楽しみなのです。
Rika-chan's such a good girl. Having such a good friend must be so reassuring.
僕に大きなハンバーグを入れて、サトコには焦げたのを入れて、サトコだけかわいそかわいそでいっぱ
い。 I take it back. Well, she is Rika-chan after all.
お見事なお手前でございましたよ。いつお嫁に行ってもおかしくない腕前ですわね。
お嫁を食べると、はぁ
レナにお嫁は NG ワードだね。以後控えるように。
ほんのちょっぴり完成しましたよ。
ところでミオの弁当は何だよ。今日のはまた趣が違って期待大だな。
おじさんはまったりと夕べのおかず詰め合わせね。煮物がいい感じなんだよ。ほら大根の色はかなりいいでしょ。
美味しそうなのです。
煮物は一晩寝かせてからが真骨頂だな。これはかなりいけそうだ。よってサトコの分はなし。俺が全部食って感想を聞かせるから黙って見てろ。
なんですって。私の分もおよこしなさいな。
アルスメンイスチューアルジャー
密着距離まで入れば私の有利は動きませんわね。ケイチさんの分のお大根が実に美味しいですわ。
ちくしょう、バトル開始時から密着でいきなりコンボとは。
This little exchange, how long had it been? It looked like they'd ended up going with theWait and see approach, but maybe her uncle had realized it gone a little too far and would dial it back now. If her treatment improved a little, would that be a good thing? Satoko was grinning wider than I'd ever seen as she chomped down on her mouthful of the daikon she'd plundered from me. Did it really taste that good? Satoko was somewhat cute like that.And just as I'd done many times, I grabbed her head and started petting it.
Satoko-chan?
It was so sudden that for a moment I didn't know what had happened.Back of my hand was stinging. I went to pet Satoko's head and then she hit my hand.
どうしたの、Satoko?
Satoko was scratching at her head as though temple or something had appeared on it and become itchy. It was so sudden and so unprovoked that I didn't understand what had happened.
どうした, Satoko?
At some point, her body had been covered in a thin layer of sweat and her breathing had turned ragged. When I pet her head, did she not like it? Was that what it meant?
お前… 頭撫でられるの嫌いだったっけ?
Once again, slowly I held out the palm of my hand and brought it close to Satoko's head. The instant the palm of my hand touched her head, there was a shock like static electricity and Satoko began to howl. She grabbed my arm in both hands, as if flinging off a snake trying to cling to her, as if trying to throw away something dirty. She threw it violently. It happened too suddenly for me to react. I hit the desk behind me and both it and I fell to the floor. The classroom fell deathly silent. Satoko bellowed. It sounded like she was in the throes of death. And she unsteadily backed away. Then she threw up the food she'd just eaten. She vomited it all back up. The sound of Satoko's vomit hitting the floor rang through the classroom.
Da-大丈夫かよ, Satoko? 具合でも…
I reached out a hand and she swatted it away with all her might, with such extreme strength that I fell onto the floor again. Satoko put both hands on her head as though protecting it, groaned some more and took a few steps back. And then she began swinging both hands around. Students in nearby seats were forced to evacuate. She grabbed anything within reach, bent the boxes, chairs, threw them, tossed them, and flung them about.
Just stop, Satoko! What happened?
She screamed out as if Mion's words had caused her physical pain. No one spoke a word to her. All the students were withdrawing behind us, leaving Satoko alone in the corner of the classroom. Around her, there were desks and chairs all over the floor. Bento lay scattered. It was terrible. All I could hear was Satoko's ragged breaths and the voices of the Kikadas. The strings of tension loosened around Satoko, and maybe she suddenly grew scared of her own actions because she started trembling and gave a word of apology. But nobody knew just who that apology was directed towards. So, for now, I decided to answer as everyone's representative.
いや、そっちこそ大丈夫か?
Her words didn't match each other at all. Satoko hugged her shoulders and back she went. She ran into the locker with the cleaning supplies in it. Even that made her give a little yelp. The impact caused the bucket atop the locker to fall, making a loud sound, and that scared Satoko most of all. She almost jumped out of her skin, grabbing a bunch of the curtain in her hands. Nobody spoke to her. They could only look, not even remembering to blink.
さい、ごめんなさい。ごめんなさい、ごめんなさい。私じゃないです。私じゃないです。
サトコ、What? What on earth? I stood up, took a step away from everyone and approached Satoko.
何があったんだ？落ち着けよ、サトコ。俺がわかるか。
もうやだ、もうやだ、やです、やです。
Every time I took a step forward, she grasped the curtains more tightly and cried out.
サトコ、俺だよ。ケイチだ。わかんないのか？お前に危害なんか加えない。落ち着けって。大丈夫だ。俺はお前の味方だって。
助けて、助けて。怖いのやだ、痛いのやだ、やだ。
Suddenly my shoulders were grabbed and I was dragged backward. It was Reina.
ごめん、ケイチ君。ケイチ君はちょっと後ろに行ってて。
After pulling me back, she ran towards Satoko in my place.
大丈夫だよ、サトコちゃん。もう怖いことなんかないよ。ほら、安心して。
やだやだやだ。もうやだやだ。でも、やだ。
As she gripped the curtains and kept calling for Nini, she continued to wail about being forgiven for something and to be saved from something. What? What is this? Mion gnashed her teeth and groaned, and there were tears falling from her firmly closed eyes.
どうなってんだよ、これ。昨日で全部終わったんじゃないのか？今日からまた元の生活に戻っていくんじゃないのか？ミオ、ミオ。
There was a crazy sound. Reina had taken the cleaning supply locker and kicked it down to the ground. Everyone stood surprised at Reina's unexpected act of brutality. After that, Reina embraced the bawling Satoko from behind and started crying with her, stifled.
Reina, どうした？
ごめん。ケイチ君、ちょっと黙ってて。
今のは何だよ？どうしたんだよ？サトコから何か聞いたのか？何を聞いたんだよ？
サイナー！黙ってろって言ってんでしょ！
フィナス raw, hostile emotion hit me like a brick. It was no more than a momentary howl of emotion for Reina.But it was more than that for me. She had shown me what was behind all that emotion, what was in her heart.
Satoko-chan.
Yada 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 yada. Oh, yada yada yada.
Yurushite.何もできなかった私たちを許して。
forgive us for being unable to do anything. Trina's words made me feel as though the blood vessels in the back of my head were suddenly all turning to ash. My vision grew distant, blurred with grey, and the world lost its color. I thought we could save Satoko, but though I knew it'd be soon, the sooner the better, I thought there was no time limit for doing that. I never even dreamed that we could be too late. I'd been making a huge mistake. I thought Satoko could be hurt, but never that she'd break. It was such a huge mistake. People, they break. Thinking that they don't is absolutely absurd. We needed to save Satoko. We needed to save her before she broke. That fatal lapse in awareness had brought this on. Whose fault was it? That went without saying. Mine, no, ours. We all took on the duty of saving Satoko, but we were negligent to the point of laziness. In that sense, this was the inevitable result. Even if this didn't happen today, and it happened tomorrow, or the day after, or next week, we would have just sat around doing nothing until that day. So this was the obvious result. I slumped down to my knees, just as Mion and Rika-chan had done, and I, too, closed my eyes tight and couldn't stop myself from sobbing. The teacher came, and her face screwed up at the terrible spectacle before her. The instant she realized the teacher was here, Satoko went through another complete change. She wiped her face with the curtains and, like nothing had happened, smiled.
Hojo-san, kore wa ittai nani goto desu ka?
Rina didn't nod in reply, but then, since Satoko wished it, she nodded without strength. The rest of the class couldn't keep up with her extreme changes. We all just stared in a daze. Satoko would probably sweep the whole thing under the rug. For what? Her heart is torn to pieces. So what? What else? You wanted your Nini to help you, didn't you? But unfortunately for you, Satoshi doesn't ever intend on coming back. It's never that easy. He won't just conveniently show up and save you. So you don't have to wait for him anymore. You can cry, beg for help, and you can run away. Mion suddenly said. She spoke then, those few words that had tormented me countless times. Those words were a spell, and when I heard them, my whole body suddenly regained its calm. My emotions all slipped away like they'd never been there. like a wave departing. And then, the world's color flipped inside out. My field of view expanded. My head grew remarkably cold and I felt like my mind's volume had grown even wider than the classroom we were in. At the time, my soul was doubtlessly no longer in the small, petty vessel of my head, but floating in the air a little bit above it. It was a mysterious feeling of release. I broke free of the cramped confines of my skull, stretched out my roots in all directions as far as I wanted to. It was a strange feeling, and one I'd never felt before. An odd sense of exhilaration. My sharpened senses caused me to transcend. My mind was sharper than a knife's edge, and I immediately decided that spending the time to let myself be crushed with grief would be an absolute waste. I erased all the garbage information from my brain. I expelled the pointless emotions presenting obstacles to action. If I could have taken back what had happened by crying about it, I'd have cried all day. But the fact was, this was how things had turned out. I couldn't take back what had happened. The top priority then would be to prevent the situation from worsening further and to sever the chains of misfortune. Until today, I'd been looking at things so narrow-mindedly, I could scarcely believe it. To save Satoko, the only thing to do was to save Satoko. That's the only thing I thought about. I didn't allow myself to realize the most basic, direct, and certain way of removing the source of Satoko's unhappiness. No, actually, I realized it yesterday. But as for the means, I'd relied on some stupid curse from some dumb deity. I never considered carrying the task out myself. I would obliterate Satoko's uncle. There were plenty of ways to do it. This was a task that held infinite methods. Ironically, the method of saving Satoko required mostly money, but the method of killing that man pretty much took no money at all. I could kill him with the least amount of investment. The least amount of money suited him. It was only the weight of his life. I kept eliminating needless, worthless information from my head, replenishing it with only the knowledge I'd need to achieve my goal. I used every cell in my brain to think about how I'd kill him. The way I killed him didn't matter. I would allow any method from whatever time and whatever country as long as it ended in a quick and certain death. If I were to have an additional condition, it would be to not get caught. Removing him was an act designed to return the peaceful times we had with Satoko. If I was arrested in exchange for the removal, then we might as well have killed each other. With only him gone, we'd go back to our normal lives. That was my supreme objective, my ultimate goal. Kill him, definitely. But definitely don't leave evidence, either. Two alternatives at odds with one another. The condition of not leaving a trace back to me automatically narrowed the number of murder methods. No witnesses was an absolute must. Fortunately, given the right time in and of itself, there would be nobody around. I mentally reconstructed the land around Satoko's house. The number of pedestrians different at different times. The movement algorithm of the neighbors. Would I lure him out or charge at him? What would my weapon be? When and where would I carry this out? Where? It needed to be somewhere I wouldn't leave a trace. When? It needed to be as soon as possible for Satoko's safety, without wasting even a millisecond. This is absurd, completely absurd. When I thought about it this way, it struck me how easy the act of killing was. If I could leave evidence, if I was just going to kill him, anyone could easily turn into a murderer. But our reason prevented that. It told us doing so would get us arrested for sure. In the end, being arrested by the police was the final thing preventing people from committing homicide. Absurd. If you went all the way out into the very middle of the ocean, you wouldn't leave any trace at all. Anyone would drop those they hated into the depths if they knew that. It was all too easy to simply remove him. I could leave class right now, grab a metal baseball bat or something from the schoolyard, go to his house and attack him. Estimated time would be 25 minutes. If I wanted us to kill each other, it wouldn't even be minutes. I could do it in 1500 seconds. I knew just how much his continued existence depended on me. He was nothing. I could expel him from this world within just 1500 seconds after making up my mind. From when I decided what to do, he only had 1500 seconds. Actually, if I ran full speed to his house, that number would go down even further. But he was alive. He was still part of this world at this very moment, having torn Satoko's body and mind to shreds. Why? Because I was letting him live. I was permitting him to live, so he was alive. If I reskinned that permission, he would be evacuating this mortal coil within 1500 seconds. You think I'd let you live to breathe even 1500 more seconds of air? I'm taking that permission back right here, right now. You'd better thank me for letting you live until today. However, I'd actually need more than 1500 seconds. I'm not just gonna end you. Getting back our old lives is far more important. It's only you I'll be cleanly cutting out of this world. They won't find a culprit. I'll forget that I dirted my hands on the likes of you as natural as I brush my teeth before bed. So to do that, I'll make a special exception for you and give you more than 1500 seconds. I'll give you a special permission to keep on living as you have until I can construct the perfect plan for your murder. Wait, Keiichi. You can't let that time go to waste. Yeah, I know. I'll kill him quickly. I'll remove him with certainty. I won't misuse any time to think of a plan. Think back. Tomorrow is Watanagashi, isn't it? Last year on the night of Watanagashi, her aunt died. Her head was busted open by some deviant and her brain splattered everywhere. That's it. He's someone who deserves to be given death on the night of Watanagashi. Hey, Oyashiro-sama. Call yourself a guardian, but you didn't protect Satoko. Cursing Satoko's family for the damn stuff is your own business, but now you made Satoko unhappy when she didn't have anything to do with it. I, Keiichi Maibara, hereby denounce you, the guardian deity of Hinamitsawa, a failure. We don't need you. Go back to the deepest, darkest part of your shrine this year. Besides, if you had just cursed and killed both her aunt and her uncle last year, none of this would have ever happened. The curse this year, it's not on you. I'll be the one deciding. It won't be the three families controlling the serial deaths behind the scenes, no. Not some vague people who I can't tell if they're buffoons or not. This time, I'll be the one to deliver divine judgment. So don't get in my way, just watch. Stay quiet and watch. I'll obliterate him. I'll wipe him off the face of the earth. I will stomp out his very existence. go away, disappear, and die. I'll tear your heart apart just like you did to Satoko. I'll have your blood as payment. Reina, Mion, and Rika-chan were looking after me. Had I fallen to the floor?
Suddenly, I was surprised. Did you get scared? Did you get scared? Did you get scared? Did you
get scared? Did you get scared? Did you get scared? Did
My friends gave a start and backed off.
Nandayo.
Reina and the others, they exchanged glances, unsure of what to say, and stood confused for a few moments.
Imano. Keiichi-kun no koe.
Atarimai daro.
Reina gulped firmly and opened her mouth.
Ima issun. Keiichi-kun. Sono.
What were these guys talking about? They've all been too scared of me lately.
Maebara Keiichi-kun, da yo ne?
What was Reina saying? Who else do I look like except Keiichi Maebara? The look I gave her seemed to speak quite eloquently to those irritated thoughts. She understood and quickly apologized.
Gomen! Kini shinai de ne!
Now, before we end the episode, we got two tips here. First, we have Emergency and D23 number 44. Let's start with Emergency. June 18th, 1983. Abuse issues regarding Satoko Hoyo, urgent. We propose that Satoko Hoyo must be taken into immediate custody based on the items below. 1. Family situation. Life with adoptive father who recently returned to Hinamitsawa has already turned disastrous, and she is currently subject to unendurable physical and mental abuse from the father. 2. Child consultation center's response. A child probation officer was dispatched yesterday on the 17th from the prefecture welfare office, but because of the 77 case changed to continued coaching and cautionary action. Unfortunately, the consultation office head does not properly understand the situation. 3. Status of concerned child. Child already appears to be suffering from an outbreak of something close to neurosis or manic depression. If her unstable pubescent mind is negatively stimulated by stress, it will put her development of a healthy body and mind at risk. This cannot be allowed to continue from a humane standpoint. 4. Allegations made to the family court. We propose, based on the above items, that Satoko Hoyo should immediately be taken into protective custody. She should be secured temporarily under emergency allegations to the family court under Article 28. We request emergency coordination between all the related agencies. D23 number 44. Fukuyishu D23 number 44. 1977. Child name Satoko Hoyo. Residence Hinamitsawa Village, Shishibune. Consultation circumstances number one. Telephone SOS from child of child abuse. 2. Abuse situation. Child claims she is being physically abused by her adoptive father. 3. Family structure. Let's see. Ball marks abusers. Adoptive father. Real mother. Older brother. And child in question. Note. Adoptive father and real mother entered family registry in 19. Redacted. The child is the daughter of the mother's previous husband. 4. Child consultation center's response. On the day of the child's telephone consultation, the center called the child's school and asked for a situation. On that day, the child welfare officer on duty visited the child's house and conducted an interview. The adoptive father sincerely listened to instruction and agreed to take child raising workshops in the city from now on. As part of the suggested coaching, the center will continue to observe the situation. 5. Other notes. As a result of numerous counseling sessions at the city's education consultation office regarding the child, we learned that there was a high possibility the cause of the child's excessive distrust towards her adoptive father was the result of a lack of communication. The abuse she claimed hadn't actually taken place. She had made a false report to distance herself from her adoptive father. Below is a note written in pencil by the person on duty at the time. The problem appeared to be more with the daughter. Chief Investigator F of the City's Education Consultation Office said that most of her stories of abuse were like the fabrications. They decided to shift the focus of their coaching to the child. Be cautious not to take everything the child says as truth. Well, interesting. I suppose maybe that goes for the Satoko we know in the game as well. Don't trust everything she says. Maybe. Anyway. Thank you for watching this episode of Higurashi. Hope you enjoyed it. I'll see you in the next episode. Goodbye for now.